Hi, welcome to Teardown Tuesday. Yes, we couldn't fit this one in the lab, so, ta-da! I'm down here in the bunker with this baby, a Yamaha M3000 analog mixer. Wow, this is bigger than my biggest bench. My biggest bench is 2.1 meters by 900 millimeters. This sucker is bigger than that and it weighs like, I don't know, a lot, like over 100 kilos or something. It is absolutely enormous. One of these professional 40-channel mixing consoles. Ha ha, this is gonna be awesome. Knobs, oh, knobs. And no, I won't pretend to know the first thing about these sort of mixing consoles, apart from the fact that they've got, well, a buttload of inputs, internal mix-in buses and things like that, lots of filters, obviously, that's what all the knobs are for, and you can mix things and filter things and adjust levels and gains and all that sort of stuff, and then mix them to the internal buses and on the internal buses and then whack them out some outputs. This one, I believe, comes from, so I was told, the original owner, come from the Melbourne Cricket Ground, the MCG in Melbourne. So, yeah, I don't know how and why he got it here in Sydney, but anyway, I picked this puppy up for practically free because they are so big and heavy. You can't ship these things. So you have to get like a professional courier slash removalist company to actually take these things. But we did manage just barely to fit it into a back of a Falcon station wagon, a big, massive Falcon station wagon. So yeah, we got it here to the bunker. I've actually had this for quite some time sitting down here. And if you were on my Patreon feed, you would have seen some photos of this puppy when I first got it. And I've been meaning to do a teardown of this thing, but as you can see, logistically, it's a bit hard. So I'm down here in the bunker. My apologies for the audio and video quality isn't going to be the best, but anyway, we'll see what we can do in the bunker here. As I said, this is the Yamaha M3000 40 channel unit. You can see the groups here, 8 channels, 8, 8, 8, and 8. So 40 channels total. Does come in a smaller version, which doesn't have the 16 extra channels, but yeah, this is the big daddy. I think you can even get extenders which go on the end of it, which can make it even bigger yet again. It's absolutely incredible. This is, you know, this is not a toy. I don't know how much this thing would originally be worth, and I don't know how much it's actually worth in fully working condition, which I believe this one is. It was apparently pulled from a working environment, but it doesn't have the power supply. And you'd think, oh, okay, it's just, how many op amps? Thousands of op amps. But when you multiply thousands of op amps and they each take 5 or 10 milliamps an op amp, it's a lot of current. This thing actually has a rack mount power supply with it, with a big connector on the back. I'll give you a tour of it before we do a teardown. But yeah, this thing's going to be fascinating. Lots of repetition in this, of course. You know, you only need to take out one of these modules to see what's in it. The others are absolutely identical. There's like a center. Once again, I don't know the term, industry terms, but this is like the internal bus one or something like that. And yeah, it's and outputs or something. Don't even know the specs because I don't actually have the internet down here in the bunker because the bunker is literally a bunker. So yeah, I can't look up stuff as I'm doing this teardown. So I'm doing this a little bit blind, but geez, this is gonna be awesome. So let's attempt to have a look at just some of the things on here. You can see the analog VU meters up there, classic. You've got to have some nice analog meters. Look at that, there we go. For you, all you VU meter aficionados, look at that. Brilliant. All for the internal matrices. So they're the internal, I believe they're like the internal buses we're talking about. So these are the all the individual controls for the matrix, the internal matrices there. So we've got ourselves 2, 4, 6, 8 matrices, and then we can go down. There's more stuff. Like, once again, I have no idea what's going on here. But you can see this is not just purely analog. If you have a look over here, it's got memory. So this thing actually has a, well, what it's called on the front is it actually has a scene memory and we can actually, it looks like, there we go, there's the scene memory, and we can recall various scenes. I assume there's some sort of, you know, like setups and things like that you can pre-program into the thing. So if you've got a concert or something, because this is actually a mobile console, by the way. It is not a studio, it's not primarily not a studio console. It's designed to go into a huge custom case and actually take this on the road and set it up, you know, at events, concert events and things like that. So it's an absolute beast. They even got carry handles on the side to actually facilitate that. It's actually quite ergonomic, those carry handles. But there's just a ton of stuff. I mean, VCA, I got no idea what that is. And wow, it's just like more knobs and buttons than you can poke a stick at. It is incredible. You really have to know what you're doing with these things. You can't just walk up to it and expect to use it. And we've got a XLR microphone input there, and we've got like an internal oscillator as well. That'd be for testing the, you know, for the roadies when they're setting it up to test the venue and things like that. So you can generate some pink noise there. Lovely. Or some test tones. Fantastic. And the test mic, of course, you can go check 1, 2 into it from the console. You can see it's still got some of the various labels and things still on here. And these things would have been labeled to the hilt by the roadies for various concerts and setups and things like that. And because you want to, the whole idea is you want to set this up. When you have to take this thing, disconnect everything and set it up on the road, you really want to be able to do it pretty quickly and efficiently. And if you're watching on HD and you can read the labels on here, you can see these matrices, M1 through M16. They, of course, correspond to individual buttons down here for all your inputs, M1 through to M16 down here. Just, the flexibility with these things is incredible. And there's our input there, and you can see the LED for the plus 48 volts. That's the phantom voltage going to the input, so you can power the microphones and other things directly from those inputs. So switch your phantom power off and on. And then you've got your various frequency band filters as well. You've got high, mid, low mid and low frequency. So you can adjust those all individual levels or for each individual input. Woo! And then if we go down that, I got no idea what they do. Levels go into the mixing buses, I'm presuming. And then we've got some, ooh, we might have some, got some LEDs, got to have those. And then once again, we've got some sort of memory as well, and the volume slider, master volume sliders, I'm presuming, master level sliders, whatever you want to call them. Awesome. Sorry, just had to do an arty shot. Oh, look at that. Let's have a look at the back of this thing. You can see all of our XLR inputs here, and we've got our direct out and insert IO, whatever that is, I don't know. And you can see a lamp XLR there as well. So that just allows a big gooseneck lamp. We've actually got three of those. If we have a look along here, there's another one and another one all the way down there. So you can have three gooseneck lamps on this puppy. Let's have a look at the serial number for those playing along at home. PX01060. Did they make 1,060 of them? I don't know. Then we've got some ST channels, whatever they are. And here's our matrix output, our mixing output, our mix insert IO, whatever all that is. Q subbing, ST subbing, mix subbing. And we can't forget MIDI, of course. And here is the big power supply input I told you about. It's got a separate 19-inch rack power supply with this thing, big multi-way high current cable coming over. None of this internal power supply rubbish, no siree, Bob. So there you have it. It's got a rear panel almost as impressive as the front panel on it. And you know what we say here on the EEV blog, don't turn it on, take it apart. Now, as for how this puppy comes apart, well, I'm guessing that this strip up here comes off, because I can see this strip up here covering the top of these consoles, and these consoles are all going to lift out. There's like 50 million screws on here. This is no good. I'm actually going to have to use my cordless screwdriver. I actually had to drive back to the office to get it. There's no way. There's like, I don't know, well, there's 50 screws on each one of these 8 panel consoles. So I might take out one of these first and have a look, but I don't know whether or not we just take out. So once we've got the strip off, I think if we take off these screws, maybe on the outside it might pop out, because these internal screws, there's tons of them in here. I won't take those out yet because they might hold it to internal racking. So I'm hoping maybe if I get the outer ones out, the whole thing will just lift out like this, and then hopefully we can have a look. So I think one of the most interesting things about this is how it's all going to be connected bus-wise between all these modules. I mean, there's going to be a huge strip PCB down here like this that holds everything, and everything will be sort of, you know, all the pots will be right angle mounted, and the buttons will be all, you know, or maybe two boards per strip. So there'll be huge, you know, modular stuff like that. Maybe not a single PCB down like that, because that'd be like a 800-900 millimeter long PCB, and well, that's not so great from assembly point of view. Will it be through hole or will it be surface mount? I don't know. We'll find out. I'm not sure of the can't remember the age of this thing, but you know, it's probably through hole, but you never know. So yeah, as I said before, it'll be like a whole bunch of op amps. There'll be just op amps galore in here, and you know, maybe 1,000 op amps or something. I don't know, I haven't done the calculations. I know you calculate how many you know, op amps and analog mixers and analog muxes and things like that you need inside this thing. So everything's probably running from like plus minus 15 volt rails inside all the analog stuff, I'd say. Whether or not they've got local regulation on each channel, I don't know. Depends how much, you know, crosstalk they think they might get between modules. It's likely that they'd have on-card regulation, I'd say. You know, they're going to spare no expense in this thing, and I believe it's, you know, quite a reasonably high performance unit. So yeah, they maybe expect some local regulation for each board like that, and well, I don't know. I've never opened one of these things before, so let's get to it. All right, took two screws off the end here, and hey, ta-da! Look at that! We're in like Flynn! Beauty! You can see the wire in here, very neat, very tidy, going to these VU meters on the front here. Look at that, it's all wrapped, no worries. And that's pretty sweet, I like that. And there's our VU meter board. We already have a bit of complexity here. Check out the single in line package I see there. Is that like going to be like a discrete transistor amplifier or something like that, transistor array? I don't know. Lots of electrodes, couple of trimmers on the side there, probably for a bit of calibration for each channel, and well, it's about all she wrote. And so far it looks like all through hole stuff. And there's only one way to find out how this puppy comes out. Let's give it a burl. Here we go. If my theory is correct. No. No. All these cards looks like individually anchored down with all these screws. Bloody Murphy. I'm very curious to see if I can lie down on this thing like a bed of nails without busting any of the knobs, because all my pressure is spread out. Well, 76 kilos of me is spread out across all these knobs. I didn't hear any break. Beauty, quality Yamaha gear, no worries. All right, I think I figured it out once I got the back, a bit of the back panel loose like this. You can't lift it up because there's a couple of tabs, like a slot in here with a key that stops it from lifting. So you've got to take the bottom part and then I think slide it forward, and then ta-da, we're in like Flynn. Check it out. And that's pretty much what I was expecting. As I said, I wouldn't have expected a board to go right down here. Obviously, they've been grouped into their various functionalities. This one here is both your this is a mono input, so this is an 8-channel mono XLR input. So this board up here is going to be your main input filter board, your phantom voltage, power supply, all that sort of stuff. So that's got a multi-channel filter. We can have a look at that in the front. And then we've got our main matrix board, or whatever it is, you know, your main matrix mixing board to put them onto the internal buses. That's one huge board in here like this. And you can see that they're all, everything's through hole in this thing, by the way. I haven't seen a single surface mount part yet. And all of the controls, all these knobs are all freestanding through hole parts directly onto the board. So one big assembly like that for all those channels. Very, very impressive. And then it looks like we've got our on-edit peak detect board. So they've got 8 of those, one per thing, and it's just got a single switch on the front plus the LEDs and a single dip package to handle that. Nothing fancy at all. And then we've got, interestingly, 2 boards for the VCA, the voltage controlled amplifier groups, or the faders down here. So we've got the fader controls, they're directly mounted onto this bottom board down the bottom here. But on the back, check it out. We've got some very serious looking dip packages there. So there, you know, everything's going to be custom on these things, because Yamaha are famous for making tons of custom parts. So, and they're probably all like Yamaha parts, or, you know, something, I don't know. Maybe there's some other industry leader that makes these types of chips. So they're probably the voltage controlled amplifier chips. So I'll give you a close up of these boards in a second. But yeah, one per channel. But you'll notice all the neat wiring harnesses as well, all tied together like this, beautiful old school stuff. So I don't know, I might have to try and get a date code on one of these packages to have a look when this thing was manufactured. Anyway, there's basically not much going off, but where it goes off to is interesting. We've got, there it is, a huge bus board running right down the middle. And interestingly, you can see that we've got some extra headers over here, presumably expansion ones, and that goes through the metal work as well down in there to expand the console on that end. I didn't know you could expand on that, and I thought you expanded it on the other end. Anyway, there's a big big beefy metal strap there, so I might actually take out the second mono input mixing console and have a look, see how far this extends. It's not going to extend like the whole length. And here's the chips on presumably the voltage controlled amplifier board. And yes, as I suspected, Yamaha branded, copyright 1994, but these particular ones, date code 1999. So this console is only, you know, about 15 years old. I don't know when they started and stopped manufacturing it, but, you know, presumably somewhere from, you know, 94, 95 to, you know, the mid to late 90s. Then here's our XLR input board, which there'd be a phantom power supply under here. And then these are various filters, because as you saw originally, here's all the different filter frequencies, high, mid, low, all those sorts of jazzes. And they're actually on the board. There we go. There's a pad, which is an attenuator. There's a high HPF, high pass filter, and there's the high mid, there's the low mid, and yeah, equalization, is it? And that's the low, if we can get that little cap up there. Oh, sorry. Yep. And there's the low pass filter. And check this out. We've got ourselves a relay here, but it looks like it's got magnetic shielding on it. There we go. Look at that. There we go, part number for those playing along at home. But yeah, little new magnetic shield on it, nice. But not exactly sure why they bothered with that. They might be gilding the lily there, because, you know, it's not exactly like it's right next to the one next to it, and they've got to stop the interaction between relays. So that's, you know, I don't know. Yeah, really gilding the lily. And you can see the label down there, nicely labeled. It's all single-sided board, of course. You know, hey, if you don't need double-sided, then I guess you don't. You can, you know, they weren't obviously going for cost reduction on this thing, you know, were they? But, you know, look, a lot of jumpers on there. But so, yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't have thought that they would have to
skimp on that to save cost. It's not a bit of consumer gear. So anyway, plus 48 volt phantom power generator for the XLR on the back. We've got ourselves a sneaky analog devices part there, SSM 2018. I have to look that one up. Once again, 1999 date code. But these little single in line jobbies aren't Yamaha, they're JRC's, Japan Radio Corp. No huge surprise for finding them. So they're going to be some, either a discrete transistor amplifier array or some sort of, you know, single in line op amp array, because they've got to implement some, you know, some filtering here, some bandpass filtering. So yeah, they need something reasonably complex. I expected to see, like, you know, 8-pin dip, you know, audio op amps, like, you know, 5532, ones like that. But no, they've gone for these JRC single in-line package jobs. Interesting. Aha, there's a familiar part number, 4580. Bingo, we've got some op amps, but in a JRC single in-line package arrangement. Unusual, I've never seen that. Next, we'll check out the little board for this functionality. We'd hear whatever's this doing on edit. Not sure, it's got some peak detect and NOMI, I don't know, signal. Let's have a look. And that's all handled by this 18-pin jobby here, and no real brand on that one. And yeah, BA, whatever that is, badass. And just because I can, if I... Bloody hell. And just because I can, take off a whole bunch of screws on the front, and these boards just lift out like that. And I've taken the fader controls off and everything, so I can actually, that's actually rather neat how they plug in and then just go right angle onto there. That's really jazzy. Lots of system engineering involved in this. Someone was really, really thinking. They've gone to town, and let's lift it out, and ta-da! We're gonna have a look at, oh, the crusty faders. Ugh. And of course, these faders are one of the most notorious things for failing in these mixing consoles, and you'd have techs going around actually servicing these things, because, you know, an expensive console, or even replacing the pots in the, well, pots, sliders in the thing, because they've just got, you know, it's a slider with some carbon tracks in there, and as you can see, it gets all crud in there. Can you see all the dust and, like, look, see, all that's just coming out from there, because it all gets in the top. And but it's, you know, it's probably not as bad as it actually looks, because they're, you know, like, you get the real good quality ones, and they're kind of like self-cleaning in some respects anyway. But eventually you use these things too often and they're gonna wear out. But these would be super high quality ones, no manufacturing markings on them though. Some of them are starting to see better days though. You can see the rust on there. Crusty. And as for this, all this matrix mixing controls here, I don't really see any any major circuitry on there. Just some, basically, the pots, the switches, and some resistors, and that's about it. Unless there's surface mount stuff in there, which I can't see from the side, but I doubt it. I think that's pretty much it. So it's just basically, you know, analog muxing through pots and resistors and that sort of stuff. You can actually see the shielded cables down in here going to it. So it's basically, you know, they've got ground planes on there. Of course, the whole chassis is shielded, everything else, and the shielded cables going over. But yeah, it's all just analog mixing on there. If that's what this thing is, it's an analog mixer. So obviously we don't have to take these other two out. They're going to be absolutely identical to that one. And I think there's one big bus board running under there. And I've taken out the next group of four. This is basically the same as this, but it's four channels and it's stereo. So we'll see a bit of a difference in the input boards up here. But you can see how they've actually changed the bus board down in the bottom there, and we'll take a look at some of the labeling on that. So we're curious to know what some of the system voltages in here were. Well, fairly simple, plus minus, plus 5 volt digital there. And we've got DG, that'd be digital ground. So that'd be returning on this big ground strip here. And you'll notice that they're going through this connector here for that sort of, for that ground connection by the looks of it, the digital ground. We've got plus 12 volts here, plus 48 volts for the phantom voltage up there. So that's so the 48 volts is actually generated by the system rack power supply, not locally on those boards. Anyway, we've got plus 12 and 312 volt ground pins, but all your big current is up here, and this is for all the op amps. As I mentioned, this big copper strap here, this is actually connecting the ground from one side to the other, because we've got all multiple rails, but everything has to return to ground. So ground is going to have the most current in it, so we need these big copper straps going over like here, like this. And obviously we've got another board inside here, which then just jumps over there. And I can just see some silk screens under there. We've got plus minus 15 volts. Now you'll notice basically the same arrangement that we had before. Here's our voltage controlled amplifiers down here. These little peak boards or whatever they are, all the same. The main mixing board here, it looks identical, except it's four channels, but the difference is going to be on our input boards up here, because they're stereo instead of mono, and you might be able to see a difference already. I can see a traditional green PCB, which looks double-sided to me. So you can see that these are stereo inputs here, and of course we require stereo circuitry. So everything is basically duplicated. All of the filters that we had before, all these bandpass filters for the high, mid, low ranges. Everything, you'll see that we've got two single inline packages for each one. Everything's doubled. We've got two relays, whereas we only had the one before. Everything's just basically doubled, and they couldn't get that on a single-sided board, hence why this one's double-sided. So really, it's all these input boards here that are really chewing the power for these things. I mean, you know, just, I'm gonna have to, when I get back and edit this video, figure out what the power consumption is for these op amps, multiply it by the number of channels. But you saw that huge big grounding copper strap we had before. They're all powered from plus minus 15 volts, as I predicted right at the beginning. The op amps, that's a typical op amp supply voltage. And they'd use plus minus 12 volt for some other stuff as well. But interestingly, like I commented at the start, there doesn't appear to be any local voltage regulation on these things. So clearly they're not too concerned with power supply rejection ratio between one board and the next one here. So they're all running from the same system power supply, but they'd have local decoupling, of course. So that's, you know, good enough. But as mentioned previously, this is not a studio quality console. This is designed for sound reinforcement. So, you know, typically 0.1% THD spec for this thing. Yamaha specs, they actually proudly boast in their data sheet that they're actually quite conservative specs, and they're over the full bandwidth. They don't cheat on their specs, etc. So, you know, but still, this is not, you know, an ultra low distortion thing you might find in some, you know, Abbey Road recording studio or something like that. So this is designed for field use, designed for concerts, venues, things like that. 0.1%, more than good enough. And there's inside the master mixing board. So these are not inputs anymore. These are basically the main mixing part of the desk, plus the outputs as well. And it folded out differently. There it is. It actually came out like this after I disconnected a couple of cables down there. And yeah, it's fundamentally a different beast to what we have with the input boards. First of all, on the top of the board here, as we saw at the start, this is the main matrix mixing part of it. It's got its own board there. You can see the board-to-board interconnects there, and that goes to this what looks like, it actually doesn't do much on the front panel, but obviously there's, you know, there's lots of action happening, lots of bus type stuff happening in there, which is rather interesting. But it's basically got like balance controls on the front and a couple of switching things, and not a huge amount more basically. But that is actually one massive board. If you take a look, there it is there. So it extends, it's
It's enormous. It's like 40 centimetres by 50 or something like that. It's quite a large beast. But little cutouts there for boards like that. One big board on the side, which we'll take a look at. And then once again, on the bottom, which is the top here, but on the bottom of the front panel, is the more VCAs, so voltage controlled amplifiers and monitoring, talkback controls and things like that. And here's our power supply section, and as we saw before, there we go, we've got plus 48 volts, plus minus 15 volts for the op amps, plus 12 volts, we've got a 12 volt ground pin and a 5 volt ground. So where's our 5 volts coming in? But anyway, check out that big copper strap, that is the ground for the plus minus 15 volts and the 12 volt analog rails and the 48 volts. That's the huge ground strap going right back to the power connector on the back. Nice. So where's Wally? Where's the 5 volt rail? Well, I found it, and you're not going to believe this. It's on this bodge board down here, and that's a 7805. Sorry about the handheld work here. That's a 7805 voltage regulator. Bolted down to the chassis as a heatsink, and that is the five volt rail. Unbelievable! Obviously not a huge amount of current on the 5 volt digital rail. It's just running some, you know, well, I don't know what it's running, but yeah, it's not a huge amount. So, you know, hey, a couple hundred milliamps or something maybe. So they're getting away with that, but it's practically an afterthought. Unbelievable. And all this stuff down here, once again, we've got probably Japan Radio Corp op amps down here, single in line packages, and for shielded relays again, these are for the mix insert connectors on the back. So I don't know what the mix inserts do, but yeah, they're just going over via the cable loom just to the grouping over there. So there they are there, and I don't know, are they doing the mix sub in as well, which is right along the bottom? I'm not entirely sure. Actually, no, those mix sub ins you saw along the bottom of the back there, they're all coming through all this cable loom here, and they're going into here, and you can see mix sub in. You can see all these resistors actually mixing them in, because that's how you mix things in the analog world, you use resistors. And there it is, sub in 2-3, so they're mixing into the main matrix bus that we saw actually running between all these things, all these mixing buses here. So we can actually plug into those externally, directly in by the looks of it. And there's no active circuitry on the little boards at the back. It looks like they're just the connectors, really. There might be some resistors on there or something, but there's no active circuitry. And then they're mixed directly into here. And interestingly, those cables aren't shielded, so they're like probably, you know, like line level. They're not really too concerned about any crosstalk or anything on those. But of course, here are our main shielded ones that we saw on the other boards. So they're coming out here, and they're snaking up and up and up and up. And it looks like there we go. They go into there, and mate, what's that one doing there flapping around in the breeze? What's that control on the front? There you go. All the shielded ones come into here. So it looks like we're selecting the matrix or something like that, perhaps. And then that brings it over here to these balancers. And then we can switch that in to the matrix. Oh, we're all in the matrix. Should be fade this to green. And again, you can see they've got the magnetic shielding on the relays there, which is rather interesting. So yeah, maybe they're just trying to stop a bit of magnetically induced crosstalk from one channel to the other when they switch one of those things. So yeah, usually you know, you get magnetically shielded or mu shielded relays like this in very dense relay matrices where they're really packed tight, like right up against one another, where activating one relay it can actually upset the coil in the other one, and it can be, you know, a bit of a problem. So yeah, but in this case, yeah, they've decided to shield those. Whether or not that's actually beneficial to stop inducing anything magnetically into the next channel? I don't know, whether or not they're just gilding the lily. And hello, Mr. Sirius. Check out all the digital stuff. We've got a H8 processor. We've got various other stuff on there. Lots of, are they 74 series something or other? Anyway, there's our digital stuff for all you digital aficionados. Yes, you've got to have something in here to do all those scene memory and, you know, things like that. So we've got a backup battery and we've got a ROM, H8 processor, old school stuff. And looks like a couple of Yamaha custom parts under there. And yeah, got to have some TTL somewhere. There we go. Peekaboo. Some more 74 series, good old ceramic bypass caps. Check it out. And looks like we got some discrete trannies there. Wonder what they're doing. And what's that Yamaha part? It's upside down. All the electrons are going to fall out. And who are you? And of course, all this wonderful stuff is also handling the MIDI inputs down there. And as for the other boards, well, that one's not worth taking out. There's nothing of interest on there, considering that everything is through hole. You can pretty much tell if there's any chips or anything else on there. This is the only other interesting board, this main one here. As I said, it looks like we've got a whole row of bigger, 28-pin DIP chips or something. So I don't know what's going on there, but it could require a bit of effort to get all that board out, all the wiring, it'd have to come out, all the screws on the front, everything else. There's not too much happening around there. And the top board up there is just our voltage controlled amplifier like we had for the input channels. I think there's actually been a repair in here. Check this out. Look, that looks like it's been repaired and hand soldered, and a bit of flux residue happening down around here. So I reckon this thing might have had a service or two in its time. One thing that's interesting to note is how we saw on all the other boards, they actually use these nice board-to-board interconnects here to join the various modules together, but they have not done that here. Why they didn't extend that out? Look, there's cables under here joining these two. Why they didn't extend that board out? Did it have to be square? Like, it couldn't have been some sort of like panel width limitation from the bare board manufacturer or the assembler or anything like that, I suspect. So I'm not sure why they just didn't make it just bigger, squarer, so it comes out here if you didn't want an odd shape, for example. Not sure why they've done that. Very curious. So there you have it. That's about as far as I'm going to go on this. I could, rip it all apart and have it look like a fantastic tear down with all its guts just spewed out everywhere, but there's a ridiculous amount of screws on this thing, and yeah, it's not very pretty in getting all the boards out. But unsurprisingly, it's not too hard to get into this thing, once you know the procedure, of course, how to get in. You know, the modules just lift out, you could disconnect the harnesses and whip in a new console, no worries whatsoever. A bit more difficult to start, like getting individual boards out and things like that, but I'll link in the service manual for this thing down below, and it's got complex disassembly procedures and everything else, so check it out. So they are designed to be serviced probably as good as you can probably hope for, given the complexity of such a beast like this. I mean, this is just the amount of controls on this thing is absolutely ridiculous. And well, you know, there's only one way to do it. If you want an analog mixing console like this with all the mixing functionality, you've got to have the knobs and the switches for everything. You know, for all, this is a 40 channel mixer. They can be much bigger than this. This one can be extended. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed that look inside a professional 40 channel mixing console for sound reinforcement applications. And yes, they do pack these up in a big case and take them from venue to venue on the road when you go see a concert and everything. Some poor bastard's got to transport this, set them all up, all the roadies and everyone else who's, you know, connects everything up and figures out how to use these things. And they're just absolutely incredible. And this, you know, they usually have a lot more than this at a concert venue if you've ever, you know, sat behind, you go to a huge, big concert and sit behind the mixing desk, it's usually a lot more stuff than this, than just this mixing console. But ultimately, no huge surprises in here, just lots of op amps, as I said, vertical boards and things like that going down and everything, all the pots, you know, they do try and minimize the wiring, even though there is a ton of wiring in this thing. They do try and minimize it, like all the pots are all either right angle or, you know, they're all PCB mount vertical or right angle ones directly on the board. All the buttons are directly on the board, so they're all designed. All the key tops are designed to be the right height, so they just penetrate from the board. And a huge amount of systems engineering goes into actually designing this thing and making sure everything can just poke through the front panel like that, and Bob's your uncle. You get all these massive amount of controls, which ultimately goes back to just one bus running between the whole lot, because that's essentially what it is, an analog mixing console. Everything's just mixed in. So it's well worth taking a look at the service manual for this thing, see the block diagram and see how complex this thing is, just the operational functionality of this, or how everything can be tied to everything else. It's, you know, and this probably isn't even one of the most complex ones on the market. A lot of, all the audio guys out there, this is just a baby unit, you know, real simple. Geez, get a complex one, Dave. So anyway, I hope you appreciate the teardown. David Tu and I actually went to a bit of effort to actually get this thing and get it down to the bunker here to actually take it apart. And now I gotta get rid of it. How do I do that? I don't know, just whack it on Gumtree or something. Maybe someone will come and take it away. I don't know. It's, you know, without the external power supply, can't even power it up. I've got absolutely no use for it. Don't want it to sit here in the bunker. So yeah, gotta do something with it. Anyone want a M3000 analog mixer? Let me know. In Sydney, gotta come pick it up. I ain't gonna deliver the bastard, that's for sure. So if you like that, please give it a big thumbs up on YouTube, because that always helps a lot, as is leaving comments and interacting and all that sort of jazz. It helps build up my search engine ranking, which is where I get half my views from, by the way, if you don't know. Just daily views, half of them don't come from subscribers. These come from people searching for my videos, which is absolutely amazing. Anyway, hope you enjoyed it. Catch you next time.